Today's topic will be on sterilization and disinfection. Introduction. Disinfection and sterilization are essential for ensuring that medical and surgical instruments do not transmit infectious pathogens to patients. Basically, our patients come with some disease, and we need to make sure that our media, our culture media, our equipments are absolutely sterile so that we don't carry any pathogenic organisms and transmit them to the patient. Definitions that we will come across, some of the terminology that we will come across in this chapter, let us look at their definitions. Sterilization, it's a process by which an article, surface or medium is freed of all living microorganisms, either in the vegetative or spore state. Disinfection, destruction or removal of all pathogenic organisms or organisms capable of giving rise to an infection. Cleaning is removal of visible soil from objects and surfaces, normally accomplished using water with detergents or enzymatic products. Decontamination removes pathogenic microorganisms from objects so they are safe to handle, use or discard. Bactericidal agent, agents which are able to kill the bacteria, and bacteriostatic agent, agents that only prevent the multiplication of bacteria. But the organisms may however remain alive. So cidal is to kill and static is to stop the multiplication of bacteria. Asepsis, prevention of infection usually by inhibiting the growth of bacteria. And antiseptic, they are chemical disinfectants which can be safely applied to skin or mucous membrane surfaces and are used to prevent infection by inhibiting the growth of bacteria like tincture or Dettol. How do you classify materials to be sterilized? They can be classified into critical items, semi-critical and non-critical items. Critical items, these are items that confer high risk for infection if contaminated with any microorganisms. And objects that enter sterile tissue or the vascular system must be sterile because any microbial contamination could transmit disease. Some of the examples of these critical items are surgical instruments, cardiac and urinary catheters, implants and ultrasound probes used in sterile body cavities. Semi-critical items, these items contact mucous membranes or non-intact skin. It includes respiratory therapy and anesthesia equipment, some endoscopes, laryngoscope blades, esophageal manometry probes, cytoscopes, anorectal manometry catheters and diaphragm fitting rings. Non-critical items, how to classify sterilization and disinfection? It is broadly classified into physical and chemical methods. Physical methods further classified as thermal and non-thermal. Thermal, that which use heat. Non-thermal, that which do not use heat. Thermal is further divided into dry heat and moist heat. And non-thermal into filtration and radiation. Let us look at the thermal methods. Dry heat and moist heat. The principle that on which dry heat works is protein denaturation, oxidative damage, high electrolyte level, toxicity. Whereas moist heat, the principle is coagulation and denaturation of enzymes or structural proteins. Under dry heat, we will be looking at sunlight, drying, hotter oven, flaming and incineration. Under moist heat, we will be looking at temperature below 100 degrees centigrade, that is inspiration and pasteurization. Temperature at 100 degree centigrade, that is boiling and tyndallization, and above 100 degree centigrade, that is autoclave. Non-thermal methods, these that do not use heat, we have filtration, radiation and plasma sterilization. Chemical methods has liquids, gases and plasma. Under liquids we have alcohols, aldehydes, halogens, phenols and surface active agents. Gases we have formaldehyde, ethylene oxide and BPL, beta propiolactone. And under plasma we have steroid sterilizer. Let us look at the factors influencing heat sterilization. One is nature of heat, whether it is dry or moist. And then temperature and time. Time required is inversely proportional to temperature. Thermal death time, that's the minimum time required to kill a suspension of organism at a predetermined temperature in a specified environment. Number of microbes. More the number of microbes there are to begin with, longer it takes to eliminate the entire population. So if there are no number of organisms, it takes longer time to get them eliminated. Characteristics of the organisms. Vegetative bacteria and viruses are more susceptible, whereas spores are more resistant. Nature of contaminated material. Presence of organic substances, proteins, nucleic acids, starch, fats and oils increase the thermal death time. And high acid and alkaline pH increases bacterial killing. Let us look at the dry heat individually. First thing is sunlight. Sunlight has a good bactericidal activity. The action is primarily due to UV rays, the ultraviolet rays, and spontaneous sterilization that occurs under natural conditions. So we keep many things in sunlight, okay, and that really has a good bactericidal effect. Drying, basically moisture is very essential in the bacteria. And drying causes the moisture within the bacterial cell to evaporate. But in this way, spores are always viable. In a sense, they are unaffected. Flaming, inoculating loops or wires, points of forceps and searing spatulas are sterilized this way. They are flamed till they become red hot. See, for example, when you look at this picture, the tip of the loop is heated, proceeding till the handle, like this. So the entire loop is heated till it becomes red hot in the flame. All the inoculating wires, loops are done this way, even points of forceps. But if the loop contains any infective proteinaceous material, you will have to first dip them in chemical disinfectants before flaming to prevent spattering. Scalpels, needles, mouths of culture tubes, glass slides, cover slips, etc. are passed a few times through the Bunsen flame without allowing them to become red hot. So as you see over here, the mouths of culture bottles or tubes are just flamed. They are not allowed to become red hot. That kills the bacteria. Incineration. Basically, incineration means burning to ashes. It's an excellent method comprising of burning the unwanted waste inside a confined space. This is an incinerator. And all these soiled dressings, animal carcasses, bedding, pathological material, plastic are just thrown into this. Okay, all the unwanted waste are thrown into this incinerator and they are burned to ashes. So it's a process of combustion, killing all the living organs. Hotter oven. This is an instrument that works on the principle of dry heat causing denaturation of proteins, oxidative damage and charring. The parts of the hotter oven: it has a double wall steel chamber with perforated shelves, a thermoregulator, a thermostat having external power supply, a stout door with insulation, mostly asbestos, a ventilator to dispose of moisture and volatile matter. How does it work? The objects to be sterilized are dried. These objects should be absolutely dry, packed and plugged with non-absorbent cotton wool and arranged inside on the perforated shelves. They should not be overcrowded, as there should be free circulation of air inside the oven, the hot air. All articles are to be wrapped in craft paper. Heating coil with fan works with electricity and that is switched on. Wait till the required temperature is reached, then keep for the required time. Mostly here it is 160 degrees centigrade for 1 hour. What are the things to be sterilized in an oven, hotter oven? All glassware, be it pipettes, be it conical flasks, slides, whatever. All glassware is the best way of sterilizing them in the hotter oven. Then forceps, metal instruments, liquid paraffin, oils, powders, all these can also be sterilized here. Precautions: cannot be used for rubbers and cloths, and must be allowed to cool for 2 hours and then only opened. If you do not do that, due to uneven cooling, there's a chance of the glass to break. To check the efficacy of the instrument, you need to use controls. We have 3 different kinds of controls: physical, chemical and biological. Physical indicators are thermocouple and thermometer. Chemical indicators are Brownie's tube. This is just a red color solution that turns green once the sterilization is complete. If it doesn't turn green, then you understand that the efficacy is not good. Biological indicators: Bacillus subtilis spores, that is Bacillus atrophius. This one, what we do is, after sterilization, these strips containing the Bacillus spores are being inoculated into a suitable medium like Tipton soy broth or Robertson cooked meat medium, and then we incubate them anaerobically at 37 degrees centigrade for 5 days. So after 5 days we look for growth. No growth indicates that proper sterilization has happened and that your equipment is good. Going on to moist heat, the principle behind moist heat is coagulation and denaturation of enzymes or structural proteins. As I already told you, we have 3 temperatures: one below 100 degrees centigrade, at 100 degrees centigrade and above 100 degrees centigrade, which we will look at individually. Moisture below 100 degrees centigrade, we have inspissation. Literally means the process of thickening by dehydration. It's also called as fractional sterilization. It is used to sterilize culture media such as LJ medium and low flow serum slow. The process is done for 2 days in an inspissator. This is an inspissator. Day 1, 80 to 85 degrees centigrade for 50 minutes, and day 2, 80 to 85 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes. The first day bacteria is killed. The second day, this being moist heat and the spores being in a favorable atmosphere, they germinate and they produce the vegetative bacteria, which is then killed. Pasteurization: it is a method of disinfecting milk using moist heat, where milk is heated initially and then rapidly cooled. It kills most of the harmful bacteria. So this is a pasteurizer. Fresh milk is added likewise, and then there's a heating section and a cooling section, and ultimately the pasteurized milk comes out. There are two types, holder method and flash method, and there's one more type, that is UHTST, ultra high temperature for short time. In all these methods, they are first heated up and then rapidly cooled. In holder method, 63 degree centigrade for 30 minutes. Flash method, 72 degree centigrade for 15 seconds. And UHTST, ultra high temperature for short time method, 141 degree centigrade for 2 seconds. Finally, they are cooled rapidly to less than 10 degree centigrade and then stored. Organisms that are not killed by the holder method are Mycobacterium tuberculosis and Coxiella burnetii. Moist heat at 100 degree centigrade. We will look at boiling first. Boiling, something which we usually do even at home. Boiling at 100 degree centigrade for 10 to 30 minutes. Kills all vegetative forms. For example, even if you see all these babies feeding bottles and vessels, usually the mothers at home, they boil it in this manner. So it's a very effective way of disinfection. Sporing bacteria require prolonged periods of boiling, and you must not use hard water. And adding 2% sodium bicarbonate increases the efficacy. It is not recommended for sterilization. It's only a means of disinfection. Tyndallization. It is a fractional or intermittent sterilization. Boiling and exposure to steam at 100 degrees centigrade for 20 minutes for 3 consecutive days. It is used for heat sensitive culture medium. The first day, the vegetative cells are killed. The second day, the early germinating spores. I already mentioned that these spores, which are in favorable medium, will germinate, causing the vegetative bacteria. So on the second day, whichever is germinating early, they will die. And the third day, late germinating spores will be killed. It is used for sterilization of egg serum or sugar containing culture media. So here is an example of this, that is Koch and Arnold steamer having the principle of tyndallization. So it has a lid, a conical shaped lid, and then a metal cylinder with a perforated shelf where we keep our things to be sterilized, and water. Water boils and then the steam rises and condenses at the surface, and that water comes down and again gets heated up, and this as a cycle gets repeated. Moist heat above 100 degree centigrade, we have the autoclave. It's the process of sterilization using saturated steam under high pressure, that is above 100 degree centigrade. Usual temperature given is 121 degree centigrade for 15 minutes at 15 lbs or pounds pressure. The working, if you see, it is very similar to the pressure cooker that we use at home. The principle is, water boils when its vapor pressure equals that of surrounding atmosphere. And when pressure inside a closed vessel increases, the temperature at which water boils also increases. Steam condenses to water and gives up its latent heat, to the cooler surface it comes in contact with. Energy from this is considerable. This is a vertical autoclave and this is a horizontal one. Looking at the parts of the autoclave, it can be either jacketed or non-jacketed, vertical or horizontal, as I have already shown you. I will show you a jacketed autoclave shortly. The equipment can be made of stainless steel or gunmetal, screw clamps to fasten the lid, and made airtight by the use of a washer. And heating is done by either gas or electricity. There are two types of autoclaves. Steam jacketed autoclave. It's a double wall chamber in which steam at 121 degrees centigrade is introduced from an external source. Steam enters the jacket from which it enters the chamber, migrating downwards, replacing the air which is expelled through a discharge tap at the bottom. I will show you a picture of that. There's another flash autoclave. It sterilizes at 134 degrees centigrade for 3 to 5 minutes. And this is used in operation rooms in emergency conditions. See, as we saw, steam enters the jacket from which it enters the chamber. So, this is your outer jacket. Okay, and this is your chamber. Steam inlet is this way. So, it goes through the jacket and then comes into the chamber, displacing the air and occupying the chamber. Okay. Autoclave procedure. Sufficient water is put in the cylinder. Where is the cylinder? The cylinder will be somewhere right below, over here. Okay. So that water boils and that steam enters over here. Sufficient water is put in the cylinder. Articles are kept above the perforated shelf. There's a perforated shelf over here where all the articles are kept. The lid is screwed tight. So, this is your lid that is screwed tight. Autoclave is heated. Discharge tap is kept open. Safety valve is adjusted to required pressure. Steam air mixture is allowed to escape freely. See, the steam enters over here, as I told you, as I showed you, and then it enters the chamber. It displaces the air. The air is sent out this way. And steam being lighter, the excess steam goes out this way. So, you have a discharge tap over here. So, there are three important things. One is the pressure gauge and then the safety valve and this discharge tap or the exhaust valve. So, the steam enters inside, it fills and displaces the air. The heavy air escapes out like this. And this steam that is coming out and the air that comes out, the steam air mixture is sent out this way. And you have a safety valve and a pressure gauge that is being set at what pressure? 15 lbs pressure. So once that pressure is reached, this safety valve will blow off like your cooker whistle. Discharge tap is closed. That is once your steam air mixture is once all the steam air mixture is out, then the discharge tap is closed. Now the steam pressure rises inside. The safety valve opens when it reaches the desired set level, 15 lbs. So once your pressure is reached, just like your cooker, the whistle blows. Likewise, here also, the safety valve will open once the pressure has reached. And excess steam escapes. The holding period is calculated from this time, that is 15 minutes. The heater is turned off when holding period is over. And you cannot open the door immediately. The autoclave has to cool till the pressure inside equals the atmospheric pressure. Then the discharge tap is open, and later the lid is opened and items are taken out. Precautions: air must be allowed to escape from the chamber because the temperature of air steam mixture is lower than that of pure steam. If the discharge tap is opened when pressure inside is high, liquid media will boil violently and spill from the container and can also explode. If discharge tap is opened after pressure inside has fallen below atmospheric pressure, excessive water would have evaporated and lost from the media. The material to be arranged to ensure free circulation of steam inside the chamber. What are the things that can be sterilized in the autoclave? Culture media, aqueous solutions, rubber materials, dressing materials, gowns, dressing, linen, gloves, instruments, and pharmaceutical products. All materials that are water containing, permeable or wettable. It's useful for materials unable to withstand higher temperature of hot air. Let's look at the autoclave controls. To ensure the efficacy of the instrument, we need to use controls like in hotter oven. We have self-adhesive sterilization indicator tape with bands that turn dark brown. And we also have paper sterilizer control strips with a heat-sensitive colored dot that changes from yellow to purple. Like in hotter oven, here too we have physical, chemical and biological controls. Physical, we have Bovidic tape. It's a tape like this that turns, it's initially almost colorless. And after sterilization, it turns to around gray to black color. Then brownie sterilization control tube. This contains red color solution which turns green when heated to 121 degree centigrade for 15 to 20 minutes. Biological control, we use Bacillus thermophilus. So even this, after sterilization, we have to inoculate into a suitable recovering medium and incubate for sterility test at 55 degree centigrade for 5 days. Going on to the non-thermal methods. Non-thermal methods do not use heat. They are divided into filtration and radiation. First, looking at filtration. It is a good and economical method of disinfection. Filtration process does not destroy but removes the microorganisms. It is used for both the clarification and sterilization of liquids and gases. It is a method used for the sterilization of heat labile liquids. Heat labile liquids, in a sense, liquids that cannot tolerate heat. Mechanism of filtration: it works on the principle of sieving, adsorption, trapping within the matrix of the filter material. Types of filtration: for liquids we have asbestos filter, candle filter, centrifugal filter, syringe or membrane filter. and for air we have HEPA filter. Asbestos filter, they are disposable single use discs. The filter disc is made up of asbestos, that's magnesium trisilicate, has high absorbing capacity, alkalinized filtered fluid, used to filter heat labile substances like serum and antibiotics or solutions of sugars. Carcinogenic potential of asbestos has discouraged its use. Some of the examples of asbestos filters are Sees filter, Carlson and Sterimat. This is a Sees filter having a stainless steel funnel with clamps, and there's an asbestos sheet, and you have the base of the funnel. This is the suction flask. The suction is connected to a motor, and when the switch is on, what happens is, because of negative pressure, whatever solution is poured into this funnel is sucked into the flask. Okay, so this is a Sees filter. Candle filter, used for purification of water for industrial and drinking purposes. These are manufactured under different grades of porosity, and there are two types of candle filters: unglazed ceramic filters and diatomaceous filters. This is a candle filter. Centrifugal filter, filtration is aided by centrifugal force. This can be used to sterilize small amount of antibiotic solutions and heat labile substances. Syringe or membrane filter, these things are the syringe or the membrane filter. It is made of cellulose esters or other polymers, usually used for water purification and analysis, sterilization and sterility testing, and preparation of solutions for parenteral use. Filtration is done under positive pressure. So whatever needs to be filtered is taken into the syringe like this, and then you fit this membrane filter over here and then push into sterile containers. For air we have the HEPA filter. HEPA is nothing but high efficiency particulate filters. So this is a very important filter. The large volumes of air can be rapidly freed from infection by passage through these filters. They remove fine particles of size 0.3 microcentimeter or larger, and widely used in laminar airflow cabinets and chambers. Available in different efficiencies from 95% to 99.997% depending on the need. Do not filter out gases, chemical vapors and odor molecules. So here is HEPA filter fit, and you have the exhaust. You have, if you can see the tiny pores over here, the high velocity air barrier, and this is a laminar airflow with the HEPA filter fit, and then you have a safety glass view screen. Uses of the HEPA filter: first, used to remove radioactive contaminants from the air in the development of the atomic bomb. Working with hazardous items such as the HIV virus, TB bacilli and other lethal bacteria and viruses for the sake of research requires HEPA filtration. In medical setup, use HEPA filtration systems. Also incorporate high energy ultraviolet light units to kill off the live bacteria and viruses trapped by the filter media. So this is a HEPA filter. Non-thermal methods, radiation. First we saw filtration, now radiation. They are further divided into non-ionizing, that is low energy type, and ionizing, high energy type. Under non-ionizing, we have infrared rays and ultraviolet rays. And ionizing, we have X-rays and gamma rays. Non-ionizing, they are low energy type. Wavelength is longer than 1 nanometer. It damages DNA by producing thymine dimers, which causes mutations. As they are longer than those of visible light, these are absorbed as heat. Therefore, they are considered as a form of hot air sterilization. It is used to disinfect operating rooms, nurseries, cafeterias, etc. Examples are infrared and ultraviolet. Infrared rays, they heat the surface of the object on which they fall. Ultraviolet rays, they damage the DNA of the bacteria on which they fall. Used to disinfect wards and operation theatres. Disadvantages of these are it damages skin and eyes, and they don't penetrate paper, glass or cloth. Ionizing rays, these are high energy type, have short wavelengths less than 1 nanometer. They dislodge electrons from atoms and form ions, cause mutations in DNA and produce peroxides. Used to sterilize pharmaceuticals and disposable medical supplies. Food industry is interested in using ionizing radiation. No increase in temperature, and hence it is called as cold sterilization. Example of ionizing rays are X-rays, gamma rays and cosmic rays. Disadvantage of them, they penetrate human tissues, may cause genetic mutations in human. Chemical methods, repeating again, they further divided into liquids, gases and plasma. Liquids, they must be stable, fast acting and effective in killing a wide range of organisms. They should not be toxic or irritant to humans. They disinfect by either damaging the cell or inactivating the essential enzymes of microbes. We classify them as alcohols, aldehydes, halogens, phenols and surface activators. Looking at them individually, alcohols, ethanol and isopropyl alcohol are widely used. They disinfect by denaturing the bacterial proteins. They are unable to kill the spores, and both are used in hand rubs. Isopropyl alcohol is used to disinfect thermometers. Aldehydes, formaldehyde and glutaraldehyde are commonly used. They kill bacteria, spores and also viruses. Formaldehyde as liquid is used to disinfect anthrax spores in wool, and as gas is used in fumigating wards. Glutaraldehyde, also known as Sidex, is used to sterilize endoscopes. Halogens, chlorine and iodine are commonly used. All the halogens are these seventh group elements. They are active against bacteria and viruses. Chlorine is used to disinfect water. Sodium hypochlorite is highly effective in killing HIV. Povidone iodine, that's betadine, is used to disinfect the skin surface of patients before surgery. Phenols, phenol, lysol, cresol are commonly used. They disinfect by causing cell membrane damage and precipitation of proteins. They are used to wipe floors, workstations and benches. They are widely used and are cheap. Surface active agents, they act by destroying the cell membrane. They do not kill spores or viruses. Common ones are soaps, benzalkonium chloride. Gases, first one we will look at formaldehyde gas. The formaldehyde gas is used for fumigation of wards and operation theatres. Basically, the room is sealed and gas is liberated and kept sealed for 2 days. The vapors are toxic and irritant. So, to remove the irritation, once the room is opened, we can release ammonia vapors that will nullify this irritant gas. Ethylene oxide, it acts by destroying DNA and RNA. It kills all kinds of microbes, but it is toxic to humans, explosive, and also destroys the ozone layer. It is used to sterilize glassware, plastics, instruments. Now not preferred due to many disadvantages. Plasma, we have the Sterart sterilizer. It is a new and highly effective method of sterilization. It uses hydrogen peroxide. Plasma actually, it is an ionized gas consisting of positive ions and free electrons in proportions, resulting in more or less no overall electric charge. It kills by free radical mediated damage of cells. It kills all organisms and is very fast acting. It is used to sterilize surgical equipments. We come to the summary. Sterilization and disinfection are important aspects in the field of medical science. Many methods and techniques are available under broad classes of physical and chemical. The correct method must be chosen depending upon the object. It's very important to routinely check whether the process and the instruments are functioning properly. Every process must have a control to check whether the process was satisfactory and efficient.